Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I please ask everyone to ensure that electronic devices are switched to silent. Our first item of business is to consider whether to take item 5 in private. Item 5 is consideration of a draft report on petition PE1758, End Greyhound Racing in Scotland. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our next item of business today is to hear from two panels of witnesses as part of our follow-up inquiry into salmon farming in Scotland. And first we will hear from John Goodlad, who is the chair of the Salmon Interactions Working Group, to discuss the group's report on addressing the interactions between farmed and wild salmon. So thank you for joining us, John. We've allocated about an hour for the first session this morning. Also joining us this morning is Edward Mountain, MSP, and I'd like you to come in with your questions at the end of the committee members' questions. Do you have any relevant interest to declare?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I'd like to reiterate that I have an interest in a salmon fishing partnership on the Rivers Bay, which relies on wild salmon. These salmon do migrate round Scotland's coast as a smolt heading north. However, there are no salmon farms that I see in the Murray Firth that could have a conflict with them. But I would like to also just declare that the salmon fisheries are normally part of a salmon fishery boards, and the salmon fishery boards represent proprietors' interests. I'm not on the board, although my partnership does contribute to it, and I believe that partnership, the Spey Fishery Board contributes to the organisation that Alan Wells is from, which is the Fisheries Management Scotland. But I have had no interaction with that organisation through the Fishery Board or through my role as a proprietor.
Thank you. So, John, given this is a follow-up inquiry, my first question is pretty obvious. It's what is your broad assessment on progress made in implementing the recommendations of the REC Committee and the Salmon's Interaction Working Group reports?
Well, I suppose that's fairly easy to answer. I think our committee came with something like 40 recommendations, and as far as I'm aware, the only one which has been really acted upon is the sea lice framework. So I think in terms of a committee that spent a lot of time producing a lot of recommendations, and I think you have to bear in mind this wasn't an easy group. It wasn't an easy group to chair. The wild fish sector and the fish farming sector both got together. And at the time, and even now, I still pay tribute to both sides for doing that in a constructive way, put a lot of effort into this. So it's very, very disappointing that so little progress has been made.
Okay, that's a good foundation for moving on to the further questions this morning. So our first theme is on research and collaboration. And can I ask Emma Harper for her question?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you. Just on picking up on the issues around collaboration, the Salmon Interactions Working Group report identified the importance of developing a collaborative professional relationships as part of working and going forward. So, and it also recommended that local engagement mechanisms between finfish farmers and wild fisheries management should take place as well. So I'm interested in you expanding a little bit about progress towards developing more collaborative working relationships.
I suppose the picture is mixed. I mean, I was asked to chair the Interactions Working Group, which I did. I have a knowledge of fish farming. I used to be a fish farmer, and I also have a knowledge of wild fish, having been involved in the sustainability movement for several years. So that particular recommendation calling for greater collaboration, I think, is just one of these common sense recommendations. You have two sectors which are in conflict. The more collaboration and working together, the greater the level of mutual understanding. And I suppose that's one of the recommendations that perhaps doesn't depend on the government implementing. It can be implemented locally, on a local level. And my understanding is that in some places it's working quite well and in other places not so well.
So the areas that it is working well, obviously, are you able to identify what makes it work well so that then that can be transferred to areas where it's not working well?
Yeah, I'm the first to acknowledge I'm not an expert in every fish farm on the west coast of Scotland or every river, but I guess like a lot of these things, it's down to people, where you have a companies and the people who are managing the fisheries in the area are working well. I had a call with John Gibb from the Lough Abber Fishery Board a couple of weeks ago, and he was explaining how he was finding working with the salmon industry in that particular area had been quite good, and I'm sure there are others who would have a different view.
Can I ask another quick one? So I'm thinking about areas in that have wild salmon, in the Solway Firth, for instance, the rivers that feed into the Solway. So Galloway Fisheries Trust manages a lot of the research around there. And then on the River Tweed as well, there are no wild salmon farms in the Solway or near the River Tweed, but research is being conducted, obviously, looking at salmon in those rivers. So is that something that would then help inform what's happening to wild salmon in other areas? But I know there are issues with the fish farms and wild salmon as well, but I'm thinking about outside of where the West Coast fish farms are, there's research that's happening looking at salmon as well.
Absolutely. And I guess today, many of the questions I'll be answering in my capacity as chair of that interactions working group, which stretched over a period of months, but to some extent, like the question you've just asked, I'll kind of be responding with my own views and own thoughts, which are unrelated to that chair. And I think the point you make is very valid. There are fish farms on the west coast of Scotland, and undoubtedly there is a level of interaction and a level of conflict between wild salmon and fish farms on the west coast. But on the east coast, there are no fish farms, and in the Solway Firth, there are no fish farms. So if the wild stocks are declining in these areas, the logical conclusion is that whatever the impact of salmon farming is or isn't, and people can argue about that, there have to be other factors at play. And so the research that's being done in these rivers hopefully will begin to answer some of those questions.
Okay, thank you.
Just before we move on, it's quite clear this is a very polarised, or could and or is, can be a very polarising topic. There needs to be a balance between commercial interests and also the huge importance of the wild salmon population. And in your report, the professional and collaborative working relationship in developing that is really important. It doesn't appear to be working at the moment. Have you any ideas how in the future the arguments should become less polarised?
It's a very good question, and I think to some extent it's a question that could be asked in so many aspects of society today, where people are talking to each other in different silos. And it's polarised, and people tend to talk to each other and shout, talk to the people that agree with them and shout at the people that they don't agree with. But we've got to find ways of breaking that down and trying to engage. And I think a lot of these things are down to the individuals on both sides. And I do believe there are enough people in the salmon farming sector and in the wild fish sector who are willing to sit down and have these difficult discussions. And I think in the interactions working group, we saw that. There were some very, very robust discussions around the table, but eventually it was a coalition of the willing. So we absolutely have to have greater discussions and to try and find common ground. Salmon farming is an incredibly important industry which has got a bright and prosperous future ahead of it. Wild salmon stocks are in a dreadful state. They're now on the endangered species but I think the simple conclusion that one is causing the other isn't the case. One may very well be one of many factors that are leading to the decline in wild salmon, and it's only through speaking and only through discussion and debate that we'll really try to get down to what's really happening to the wild salmon stocks.
You know, we heard last week one of the remits of CEPA is to facilitate that better engagement, and two of its tasks were to do that, and from what we can see that's completely failed. Are they on the wrong route to establishing better collaboration, and, or you know, are we going to find that in 2 years, 3 years time we're still discussing the polarised arguments and they haven't actually achieved that professional and collaborative working relationship?
I think ultimately the better relationship between the wild fish sector and the salmon farming sector has to come down to the people in these two sectors. Relying on an intermediary body, a regulatory body like CEPA, I don't at all disagree that they can play a role, but that's not going to be central. It's got to be the people on both sides who are directly involved. You can't expect or rely on an independent third party to do it. There's got to be the willingness to do it on both sides.
Okay, thank you. Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. You just painted a picture about just how varied the reasons why we perhaps are seeing the decline in wild salmon populations are. It's a very complex picture. And one of the things that I was interested in is the fact that the working group report called for Marine Scotland research to determine a baseline for current levels of genetic introgression to be expedited. And because obviously we didn't have the understanding of, you know, what is the actual picture across the country. And, you know, in Ayrshire, I see that the work that my father as a volunteer in the Ayrshire Rivers Trust does to actually look at the River Arven in front of my house and that flows through where I live to try and understand why are those levels of wild salmon, you know, decreasing so rapidly. Now that that report's been published, what does it reveal about the impact of interbreeding between farmed and wild salmon?
I'm afraid I don't. I've not read that report, so I'm unable to answer the detail of that. Talking more generally about genetic introgression and speaking to the wild fish sector, I think that the two main concerns which the wild fish sector have, and these are legitimate concerns about fish farming, is sea lice. As smolts swim past fish farms, they may become infected with sea lice. And secondly, the risk of escapes and genetic introgression. And it has been put to me that with wild salmon stocks at such a low and indeed endangered level, that genetic introgression is probably a worse potential problem than it's ever been. However, on the other hand, I also believe that the level of escapes is probably at as low a level now than it's been for many years. So there is a problem. As to what the extent of the problem is, I can't say.
Yeah, I mean, I think from the report that we can see that where there is introgression, it's kind of concentrated round about where there is aquaculture happening versus, you know, the migration of smolts and getting into some of the rivers, which I think was one of the major concerns that was. So there may be some fears allayed there, but there absolutely still is evidence of introgression genetic nature.
No, that's very, very interesting. And that would seem to suggest then that the genetic introgression is very much a West Coast issue, which is where the fish farms are. And I wonder if there is any evidence at all of genetic integration with regard to the stocks on the East Coast.
Do you think there needs to be further research in this area about looking about, you know, at the integration?
Absolutely. And I think the honest answer is that no one really knows why wild salmon have declined so drastically. I think there are 12 reasons that have been put forward, and we referred to them in our report. And clearly, fish farming is one that gets a lot of attention and is one that quite rightly gets attention. But there are perhaps 11 others, and there needs to be so much work done on all of these areas. And some of these, it's very easy in some ways to do work on what we can see. We can see fish farms at sea, but some of the other threats to wild salmon are much more difficult to see. They happen in the middle of the North Atlantic. They happen way out to sea, and this is much more difficult to research, but absolutely critical that that work is done so that we can really begin to understand what's happening to this iconic species.
Thank you.
I've got a supplementary from Rhoda Grant and Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, and just wonder what thought has been given to climate change, because one of the reasons put forward for the decrease in wild salmon numbers is that heavy rain at the time of fish spawning in the rivers. And I also wonder, in Norway, they close wild fisheries on rivers when numbers are low. Should we be looking at something like that? And should we be looking at better river management to protect wild salmon numbers?
I think there's two questions there, and if I can take the second one first, which is, you know, and then I'll deal with the wider issue of climate change secondly. I think last week in Norway, several rivers were closed to angling, and the point has been made, and I think will continue to be made with greater force. You know, what kind of society continues to allow an endangered species to be fished for sport? So I think there's a very, very big question there. On the angling side, people will say, well, if we don't have angling, we'll not get the information that we need on wild stocks and so on. So in terms of river management, we have a stock that's on the endangered species, and I think that's a big issue that the wild salmon sector will have to address and look at, should fishing continue. On the wider issue of climate change, and I'm glad you've asked that question, because I think, speaking personally, if I was asked to place my bets on what the main factor leading to wild salmon decline is, I believe it's happening in the North Atlantic. The salmon smolts go to sea, and they feed in the waters between Faroe and Iceland and Greenland. Something's happening out there, and I've discussed this at great length with the late Ori Vigfusson from Iceland, who probably did more than any other individual to protect wild salmon stocks through his programme of persuading the Faroese and Icelandic and Greenland commercial fishermen to stop catching them in the 1980s and 1990s. And he and I agreed that the climate change has resulted in two things happening with the western mackerel stock. First of all, the western mackerel stock biomass is now at record levels. A historical level of 2.5 million tonnes of western mackerel is now currently around 4 million tonnes. Secondly, that stock has moved northwards. The mackerel fishery used to be off Cornwall and off the Western Isles. The main part of that fishery now, Shetland, is the southern part of the fishery. It's mostly around Faroe and Iceland. So that huge 4 million tonnes biomass has moved north. Mackerel eat exactly the same that salmon eat. They eat capelin and they eat crustaceans. And large mackerel also eat small salmon. So in my opinion, the relationship with this huge mackerel biomass and the wild salmon stock has never really been fully explored. And I believe that that is part of the very complex set of reasons as to why wild salmon are in such a precarious state.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
I want to just go back to the collaboration and engagement between both sectors. And I'm interested to know how the interactions group that was formed previously to the current one, if there's anything that you have done that has improved or been different from that previous group, and when you decided to look at how you would take forward actions, if there was something specific that hadn't been done that you committed to. And I just wondered how this whole relationship has either improved or declined since there's been an announcement to double salmon farm production by 2030.
Yeah, I'm not sure I understand what you're saying. I'm not sure if I fully answered what you're asking me.
Yeah, so the salmon interactions group
previously, we didn't have anything to do with that as a committee. And obviously, you took on leadership of a new working group. I wondered, was that basically because, why was that? Why was there a new interactions working group? Had you picked up on anything that from that interactions group needed to be improved in terms of engagement and collaboration, or did you just start with a clean slate?
Yeah, it was my understanding that the Scottish Government has identified a number of potential reasons for the decline in wild salmon. Climate change in rivers and at sea, predation by birds, predation by mammals, degradation of rivers, a huge range of potential issues, including salmon farming. And recognising that there were these many areas of potential problems for wild salmon populations, the Interactions Working Group dealt with one of those. And I think it was the understanding of the Interactions Working Group that once it finished its deliberations, that the Scottish Government would then move on and do similar work looking at the other pressures. And I think to some extent that really hasn't happened.
Okay. Can I just pick up on the point that I made around the announcement from the industry, Scottish Government, that they would commit to doubling salmon production by 2030, and what sort of impact that's had on, has it been a negative or a positive impact, I suppose, on the relationship between those in the farm sector and the wild fish sector?
I would imagine that most people in the wild fish sector are probably hugely disappointed that the salmon farming industry, which they perceive as being one of the problem areas for wild fish salmon, is going to increase, whereas I'm sure those in the fish farming sector welcome the increase because it's a great business, it brings great prosperity to the west coast of Scotland. So that probably hasn't helped the level of collaboration between the two sectors, although I would say that part of the proposed expansion will be the same as has happened in Norway and the Faroe Islands, where these are bigger sites, further offshore, likely to be less in near the mouths of rivers. So perhaps, although an expanded capacity will still be more farmed salmon in the water, its location might be in a less... would be in an area that would be perhaps cause less problems, less wouldn't be so near where wild salmon are coming back to rivers and smolts are going to sea, although that is yet to be seen.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to the next theme and sea lice and regulatory reform. Beatrice Wishart.
John. The REC Committee and the Interactions Working Group report, they identified the need for a lead agency to take responsibility for interactions between farmed and wild salmon. And we know that SEPA took responsibility for managing sea lice and wild salmon interactions from the beginning of February this year. And next March we'll take responsibility for managing sea lice and sea trout interactions. So do you consider the identification of SEPA as lead regulator to have addressed that gap, and has this led to more positive outcomes?
I think the identification of SEPA to undertake this work is a good first step. I think it's too early to say whether it will be, or it has been effective, or indeed will be effective.
Yeah. And are you satisfied that SEPA has the capability to effectively regulate the interactions between wild and farmed salmon?
I honestly don't know.
Okay.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. My question's been answered in that line of questioning. Thank you.
Okay, that's good. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, John. Thanks for joining us. I've got a question around the precautionary principle. Both the REC committee and the working group reports recommended the need for a precautionary approach to mitigate any impacts of sea lice infestation on wild salmon. And I'd be interested to get a sense from you if you think SEPA's sea lice risk framework applies a precautionary approach, given it's, I think, the only one you said that it's only one of your recommendations that actually has been applied since you made your report. Yeah, be interested to hear what you're thinking about that.
I mean, I guess the general principle of the precautionary approach is well established and accepted. I think the difficulty is that what the precautionary approach is to one person can be completely different to what it is for somebody else. It covers a huge area. And so whether the sea lice framework is a sufficient application of the precautionary approach, I think, will depend on your perspective as to what you think the precautionary approach really means.
Okay, I think we've kind of discovered that a little bit during our inquiry so far. So there's a definition from the Scottish Government. Decision makers should apply the precautionary principle when there is both a good reason, well, it's not a definition, but kind of when we apply it, when there's both a good reason to believe that serious or irreversible environmental damage could occur and a lack of scientific certainty around the consequences or likelihood of the hazard or associated risk. And in this case, we're talking about the risk to our endangered wild salmon. And my understanding of the kind of the SEPA framework, the sea lice framework, is that it's really about taking... It's about taking data. It's not actually going to take any action, and that we're going to be in a process of 5 years of looking at data, but in meanwhile, our wild fish are on the endangered species list. So I'm just wondering if you have a sense that are we really, is SEPA really taking an approach that really addresses the risk that we really might see the end of our wild fish in Scottish waters?
Yeah. I suppose my heart sinks when a government agency or any other agency says they're going to take 5 years to analyse data. However, without data, we don't have any evidence, and all we have are people's opinions. So data is important, and it's my understanding that sea lice levels, and these will be being reported to SEPA as we speak, are at some of the lowest levels we've seen for a long time in the industry. So it does beg the question as to, you know, what more needs to be done in terms of sea lice management, given these very low levels of sea lice that I think my understanding is are apparent and have been for the last 2 or 3 years in most farms on the west coast of Scotland. And I think that lower level of sea lice is a reflection of the wide range of treatments that are now being used, and of course the great innovation of cleaner fish, which is a non-chemical intervention to help keep sea lice numbers at a low level.
But comes with its own problems in terms of over-harvesting and in terms of mortalities in that case. But just on the kind of the sea lice part, and one of the things is that SEPA has this idea of no deterioration. But what I want to try to understand, I'm hearing that we're having problems with our wild fish and the no deterioration of wild salmon. Can you say a little bit more about that?
I'm sorry, the question was we're having problems with wild salmon?
Well, so we've got our wild salmon are endangered, and SEPA has this approach of monitoring no deterioration. But from what I understand with that, it's no deterioration of farm fish rather than wild fish. But I think we need to be looking at the fact that we're going to be seeing deterioration of wild fish.
I think that's right. I think the evidence is for the last few years that sea lice levels on fish farms are at some of the lowest levels that have been for some years. But I'm not sure what research is being done on what level of sea lice are being picked up by salmon smolts as they proceed to sea. It's obviously very difficult to do. These are small fish swimming out from rivers going into the sea. But that's really important information. And likewise, I think it would be really interesting to see, you know, as smolts leave the East Coast rivers where there are no fish farms, do these smolts pick up sea lice naturally or not? because sea lice is a natural phenomena. It's not something that's a result of fish farming. It has been exacerbated by fish farming, as all intensive agriculture does with parasites. But the relationship between sea lice and wild salmon has been a relationship that's existed for as long as wild salmon have been there.
That certainly is the case, but I've heard anecdotally that there are curtains of sea lice in the lochs where there's fish farms. So it seems that there's an increased amount of sea lice where there's a presence of fish farming, and hence the need to do all of these chemical or cleaner fish mitigations to try to keep the numbers down.
Yeah. Data is important, evidence is important, and frankly, I hear anecdotal evidence from all kinds of people every day, and it is what it is, it's anecdotal.
And what about...
Sorry, we're going to have to... One last question
about the amount of sea lice measurement, and that's related to precautionary approach. So what we heard last week from SEPA is that they're taking a case-by-case approach to sea farms and the level of sea lice. What we know from Norway is that they've brought in this zero... During the spring, with female sea lice, they have taken in this approach where they want to see 0.2 sea lice. I'd like to understand your thoughts around that, whether we should be taking more of a broader approach or this case-by-case approach is the appropriate thing for Scotland.
I think as a general principle, I think a case-by-case approach is always... In this case, I think is best because the circumstances of each fish farm is different. There are some fish farms whose location placed them nowhere near any rivers and any smolts going past. So is it appropriate that they have a blanket 0.2 or whatever applied to them as a fish farm in the mouth of a river where there are wild fish populations going past, going up the river and coming back from the river? So I think the circumstances of the location of each fish farm would suggest that a case-by-case approach is the best one. I'm always, in dealing with something, and we find this in the fishing industry as well as the fish farming industry and wild fish, a blanket approach of the cold, clammy hand of government rarely works when dealing with something so complex. It's far better. Each river mouth is unique, each salmon farm location is unique, each wild fish population is unique, and I think there are better results gained by taking these on a case-by-case basis.
Okay, thanks.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, John. Just a quick question still on the regulatory system. The Salmon Interactions Working Group report recommended that the reformed regulatory system should be fully resourced, and it should meet the tests of being robust, transparent, enforceable and enforced. Have these tests been met?
Given that there has been really very little change since the Interactions Working Group made those recommendations, I would say no.
Have any of these tests been met?
I'm not as close to the regulatory situation as perhaps others are, but I know that the Salmon Scotland, representing the salmon farming sector, believe that the whole regulatory system remains cumbersome, it remains lengthy, it takes a long time to get a decision on siting of a fish farm. And I know from the wild fish sector that the taking into account of wild fish populations in determining the location of a fish farm is far from satisfactory. So I think there continue to be criticisms from both sectors.
Given the current state of the regulatory system, is it being adequately enforced, what we have in place?
I don't know the answer to that. That's my honest answer.
And You talked about it being cumbersome. Does that mean there's a lack of transparency in how it operates? Is there a difficulty in implementing it?
I think what I was meaning when I said cumbersome is that the I think it was called the Griggs report, suggested that there should be a streamlined process for looking at new salmon farming applications. It doesn't mean an any less rigorous approach, but it just meant that instead of getting a licence from SEPA, from the Crown Estate, from the local authority, that these were various permits that were required and they could all take a long time, and different organisations were asking for different things. There must be a better way of ensuring that the process of granting fish farm permissions is done in a less cumbersome way. Not, I would stress, meaning it's any less robust in terms of saying that only fish farms that meet certain criteria should be licensed to operate.
You've described part of the operation in achieving a licence, having to apply for multiple licences from various bodies. Are these done concurrently or consecutively?
These are done, I would imagine, at the same time, consecutively. But I suppose each individual fish farm will have their own methods of, you know, do they go to the Crown Estate first, do they go to SEPA first, do they talk to the local authority first? I guess it'll depend on what each company's priorities are.
I suppose what was in my mind was, are you having to apply to SEPA first, before you can apply to
Colin,
the
Colin,
state
can I stop
before...
you? We're actually jumping on to a section that's going to come at the end of this line of questioning. If you could restrict your questions to the sea lice regulatory reform at the moment, we're going to move on to planning and consenting at the end of the session.
Okay, Grant. From what you're saying then, the current regulatory system, you say, is a bit cumbersome. Is it robust in any way? I mean, I'm grasping at straws here to try and tease out where the strengths and weaknesses are in the existing system.
Yeah. Well, I suppose I chaired the Interactions Working Group, and I'm aware of the criticisms of the existing system from the fish farming sector and from the wild fish sector. As regards that specific question, I'm probably not the best qualified person to talk about, you know, in terms of robustness, in terms of enforcement. You're probably better asking the people in the fish farming sector and the people in the wild fish sector. And although they disagree about many things, I think you'll find a degree of commonality that neither of them think that what we have at the moment is the best, possibly for different reasons.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We've now got a final question to this section from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. This is about the REC Committee's recommendation 22, which recommended enhancement in the way that sea lice data is presented, and the committee called for a comprehensive and accessible reporting system. I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are in the way that the data is currently presented, and if you think it is comprehensive and accessible.
This is in terms of the data that the fish farms provide to SEPA.
I believe so, yeah. So the recommendation is that in order to increase transparency, there needs to be a significant enhancement in the way that sea lice data, yes, it must be, and other key information related to the regulation of salmon farming is presented.
Yeah. I mean, I chaired the Interactions Working Group 4 years ago. This is one of our key recommendations. It's my understanding that that is being done now, but I'm not that close to it. I'm sure it's being done better in some places than in others, but my understanding is that that is being done.
Okay, so where would we need to go? Who would we need to talk to? Who would be able to give a definitive answer on that?
Well, I guess SEPA would be able to tell you, you know, are they getting all the data that they need to get? I guess the individual farms, are they, in their opinion, complying with what's expected? And then I think you're hearing from the Fisheries Management Scotland later today. I think you have to ask what, in their view, you know, is what's happening suitable.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Now we move on to the theme of escapes, and Emma Roddick.
John, has there been sufficient progress made by the Scottish Government on recommendations made by the Salmon Interactions Working Group regarding escapes? And are you aware of any progress on providing a mechanism for monetary penalties to be applied and invested in wild salmon conservation work?
Yeah. I think that's a very good question, and of course all of the recommendations which the Interactions Working Group made were regarded as important, but I would highlight the recommendation on escapes as being particularly important. And this was a group which represented the salmon farming sector as well as the wild fish sector as well as others, and the group recommended that there in future there should be monetary penalties applied to escapes. Now, that was a very powerful recommendation to come from this group, especially that the fish farming industry were represented on that group. That was hard fought for, and I think credit has to be given for that. Unfortunately, there appears to have been very little, if no progress, made in that respect. And I think the point you make the thinking is that if there's a monetary penalty applied, that will be yet another deterrent to try and prevent escapes, although from a business point of view, if your livestock escapes, you lose a lot of money. So no fish farmer wants to have their fish populations escape. But it would be another layer of deterrent. And I think more than that, if that was to be introduced, rather than that money going to government, that money should indeed be deployed within the wild fish sector for improvements to river, for wild fish restoration, for all the kind of things that you've mentioned. So a very important recommendation, and the simple answer is no, there's been very little progress on that.
Thank you. I appreciate everything you've said there, and just thinking a bit more about, you know, the simple act of the fish escaping should be a deterrent in itself that encourages farmers to prevent escapes. We have also had witnesses to the committee so far who have struggled to state what could prevent fish escapes, and given the volatility of the numbers year on year, do you believe that there are ways and means open to farmers who can prevent escapes enough to make it a liability on them if fish do end up escaping?
Yeah, I mean, I think the deterrent is that, you know, you're running a business, and if your livestock escapes, it's a huge financial blow to the business, quite apart from the environmental problems that escaped fish are causing. So the deterrent is undoubtedly there. And I think the fact that escapes in terms of numbers of escapes and numbers of fish escaped are at much lower levels now than they were 10 years ago, 20 years ago, is a reflection on how well the industry is managing to contain escapes. I think technology has a huge role to play. The quality of nets on fish pens is so much better now than it used to be. There's often double netting on fish pens. The nets are weighed down. The two main reasons for escapes, one is storm damage, where you get a storm and the waves and swell are placing pressures on the net, so the net tears. That's much, much less frequent now because of the higher quality of netting used. And the other main cause of escapes is attacks by mammals, especially seals, attacking the nets, tearing a hole in the nets and allowing the salmon to escape. So with the acoustic deterrent devices and the much better net quality and the weighting on the nets to make the netting almost a wall rather than a curtain that a seal can push up against. All of these things have worked incredibly well. But you will never, ever, in any industry, whether it's a farmer with cattle or a farmer with sheep, you will never, ever be able to say that my fences are completely secure, that I can guarantee that an escape will never happen ever again. I think huge progress is being made, and I think escapes are much more unlikely than they used to be. But you are dealing with a population of fish at sea in some of the most challenging environments.
Okay, thanks for that. Your report identified good practice in Norway by an organisation called OURO, which is responsible for removing escapee farmed fish from bodies of water. Could you explain to the committee how that process works and if similar practice could be implemented in Scotland?
To be honest, I've forgotten about that discussion we had at the Interactions Committee. I think, you know, in the Norwegian fjords, escape fish, there's various ways through netting that you can try to catch escape fish. I guess based on the principle that farmed fish behave differently from wild fish, they're fed twice a day. So they will maybe, after they escape from the pen, hang around for a bit in the hope that somebody will continue to feed them. So they remain a population that could still be caught by nets. Whether in reality that happens and whether in reality that could be transferred from Norway to Scotland, I don't know. But everything that can be done to prevent an escape happening in the first place, and then everything that can be done to recover any escaped fish, of course, should be done.
And are there ways that you've seen be more successful around preventing escapes in the first place that you think Scotland should be considering?
I don't think there's anything out there in terms of technology which the Scottish industry, which is in the forefront of the global salmon farming industry, isn't already doing. I mean, there's no silver bullet out there that the Norwegians or the Canadians or the Faroese are using that the Scottish fish farmers aren't using to prevent escapes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just before we move on, other than the economic impact of fish loss to the salmon farmer, is the main or only issue with escapes the introgression, the genetic interaction between wild and farmed salmon? Is that the number one issue that we have here? Are other issues that escape fish can cause to the wild salmon population?
It's my understanding that genetic integration is the fear that a population of domesticated animals whose behaviour is quite different from the behaviour of wild fish. Maybe somebody once said that it was similar to wild boar and pigs being farmed. It's maybe something, maybe not an exact comparison, but something similar. So you don't want them to interbreed and to take away the genetic uniqueness of the wild salmon population. So that's the main problem by far.
So I understand that the salmon, the aquaculture industry is looking at genetic modification, if you like, of some description, which would mean that farmed salmon were actually sterile, weren't able to breed with the wild salmon. Is that something that you're aware of, and has enough progress been made in that front, and is there more that can be done?
I am aware that work has been done on that and continues to be done that in many parts of the world, and I think it comes with a lot of caveats. A lot of people, I think, are very sensitive about taking that step. It's kind of genetic modification, and there's a lot of opposition, and quite rightly so. I think it's something that needs to be investigated, talked about carefully, and all the advantages, you know, the obvious advantage that would stop any escapees breeding with wild salmon. So that would solve that problem. But at the same time, are you then creating other problems with genetic modification of your farm stock?
Okay, thank you. Move on to our final theme, which is around consenting and planning. Beatrice Wishart.
John, you touched on in response to some of Colin Beattie's questioning about a streamlined approach, as Professor Griggs had outlined in his report. Your report recommended consenting of new developments should be managed with an adaptive spatial planning model. I wonder if you could say a bit more about what you envisage with that.
Mm-hmm. I think this was referring to the long discussions we had at the Interactions Working Group about how the industry should develop, and the thinking that if it was easier to get a fish farm site consented for an area further offshore, the fish farming industry would willingly give up their fish farm site at the mouth of a river. So that whole consenting regime in terms of adaptive spatial planning so has to be attuned to being flexible and allowing the fish farming industry through developing their industry and moving offshore. It may very well be that you have larger bodies of farmed salmon further offshore, but you have far less farms in Scotland, and many of these smaller farms near the mouths of rivers would be removed. So it's good news for the wild salmon. They don't have fish farms so near river mouths, but it's good news for the fish farm industry. And I suppose the example in the Faroe Islands is very pertinent. It used to be like Shetland and like Scotland, lots of small fish farms, and the Faroes have now moved to a very small number of very large farms with a huge separation distance from each other and really in quite exposed sites. And I do feel that's the way the industry will develop in the future. The economics points to that from a fish farming point of view, but from a wild fish interaction point of view, that has to be good news. And you're taking away the fish farms from river mouths where the sea lice interaction is going to take place.
And do you think there's been any progress in moving towards this consenting model?
Again, I'm not as close to it as others, but in speaking to the fish farming people, their response is absolutely not. So, unfortunately, I think there's not a lot of progress that's been made.
Thank you.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. So the report also recommended that there should be local engagement mechanisms between finfish farmers and wild fishery managers. Has there been any progress in improving engagement on consenting decisions?
I think it, as I think I referred to earlier, it's very much depends on who you're talking about in which locations. I think in some areas there are very, very good relations between fishery managers and fish farms. I mentioned a conversation I'd had quite recently with John Gibb off the Loch Abber fishery and the fish farms in his area. In other areas, I know fish farmers and wild fish managers are really very poor neighbours to each other. So I think it's very good in places. In other places, it's pretty good. And in some places, I think a lot of progress still to be made.
And in terms of wider engagement, we have had some discussions in the committee around how local communities can have their views more represented in terms of where's an appropriate place and what appropriate activity can go on there. How far do you think we have to go, and what early steps would you like to see taken to improve that engagement?
Yeah, I mean, I guess one response to that is that people living in a local community do have the opportunity to express their views through an application for a works licence to the local authority, or an application for tonnage consent to SEPA, or indeed a Crown Estate lease. They have the opportunity to say, I think this is good, I think this is a bad idea, or I think it should be moved somewhere else. So I guess that mechanism exists already. And I think it's community engagement is incredibly important, of course. But it's also important, I think, in these communities that very often the views of a vociferous small group of people can be mistaken for the overwhelming body of opinion of people who aren't saying very much.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. Edward Mountain.
Thanks very much, Convener. John, I read your report, May 2020, I think it was. You would be proud of it, like I'm proud of the REC committee report with 65 recommendations in it. Would you be as disappointed, or do you think I'm right to be disappointed, that very few of the 65 recommendations of the REC report have been actually implemented?
As somebody who chaired a committee who hardly any of their recommendations have been implemented, I'm disappointed. So I would imagine you're absolutely right in being disappointed in with regard to your committee.
Okay. One of the things that has come out, I guess, on all of this is salmon farmers and wild fish interests and other interests, sea interests, users, need to be good neighbours. Do you think salmon farmers are good neighbours?
In some cases, yes. In some cases, probably not.
Okay. And then my final question is a very simple one. We've heard from industry on numerous occasions that some of the most vulnerable times is when young smolts are put to sea to be put into their cages. They have very soft skin and they need to be medicated often before they go out to give them some long-lasting protection against sea lice, i.e. they're prophylactically treated before they go out. Now, would you say that a smolt from a wild river going past a fish farm where there are sea lice, could you say whether it's going to survive or whether it's not going to survive if it picks up two sea lice or three sea lice?
I don't know the answer to that. I do know, as I said earlier, that sea lice are a natural feature of wild salmon. And like many people in Scotland, I remember catching salmon when I was a very young man, and it was very rare that we caught salmon without sea lice. That was long before fish farming ever became a thing. So sea lice are natural. Now, whether two sea lice on a smolt going to sea is too much, or whether two sea lice on a smolt going to sea is perfectly normal, I don't know.
I mean, I think my problem is there's no monitoring of the wild fish when they go past a fish pen, so you have no idea of the effects it would be. And I absolutely take your point that they've always had sea lice on them. But animals have always had liver fluke and various types of worms, but the more intensively they're farmed and the closer they're kept together, the more you have to treat them for it, and the more that they will pick up liver fluke and other worms in paddocks if other animals have got it. So my final question, if I may, when we're looking at salmon farming and wild fish, what would be the one thing that you think that would make the biggest difference to both of them getting on better, which the salmon farming could do?
That's a very good question. And speaking personally, I think what the two main problems that the wild fish sector believes that salmon farming is contributing is sea lice and escapes. So I believe what the fish farming industry is currently doing to limit the numbers of sea lice through a variety of treatments, through better locations of fish farms, through the use of cleaner fish, and keeping sea lice levels to as low a level as possible, which they're already doing, and to try and minimise and hopefully eliminate escapes. That's the two main things that they can do to help the wild fish stock. However, in an impossible world where there was no sea lice whatsoever and no escapes ever, I still think the wild salmon stock would still have a problem. And that's why we have to look beyond salmon farming at what is really causing the wild fish stock to decline in such a precipitated fashion. It's, my goodness, it's on the critical, highly endangered list. And I come back to the comment I made earlier. I think the solution or the answer to that fundamental problem doesn't lie in the west coast of Scotland. It lies out in the North Atlantic, where the salmon are feeding and where this huge biomass of mackerel now swims.
John, and I probably agree with you. If you look at the North Esk figures on the counts, smolts returning used to be about 25%. They're usually about two. They're down to possibly 2% at the moment. So it indicates a wider problem. But you raise the issue that you question whether people should be fishing at the moment for an endangered species. Now, for example, I know for a fact on the Spey, because I follow it regularly, that the 96% of salmon were returned, so a very small number are killed. So if salmon fishers should give up, would there not be an argument that salmon farmers should give up on the basis they're probably damaging more fish than fishermen?
I think if I could go back to what I said, I wasn't suggesting that angling should be stopped. I raised it as something that other people may suggest. Highly endangered species, should you still be catching them for sport? I wasn't suggesting that. I was making the point. I think in answer to what you're saying, should salmon farming be stopped, an industry that employs thousands of people, makes a huge contribution to the economy, actually helps lots of people stay in remote areas. You know, it's an industry, it's producing food. Is that the same as something that people do for sport? I don't think so. I'm not suggesting it should be stopped, but I think the comparison isn't a valid one.
Okay, so where you and I agree is I think that salmon farming should definitely continue. I think it's important, but as a good neighbour, as far as salmon fishery is concerned, I would actually say to you, you probably ought to look at the last government's report on salmon fishing and the amount of jobs and the amount of money it brings into the local economy, probably as significant in remote areas as salmon farming does. Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It's just to go back to collaboration and professional engagement and working. I'm reading here that from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration in America, looking at what's happening in Canada, we've got Pacific salmon in decline as well. So all throughout, whether you're in the Pacific waters or Atlantic waters, wild salmon is in decline. So going back to looking at collaboration and professional working, we need to work together globally to look at why wild salmon populations are in decline. So is that something that we need to obviously highlight, that professional working does need to happen globally and Scotland needs to be part of that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the Atlantic salmon, in the Atlantic there is only one species of salmon, in the Pacific there are five. And Pacific salmon, all five, are in different levels of decline. Of course, it's different in the Pacific. You have a huge commercial fishery for salmon, and the smolts going to sea in the Pacific are nearly all farmed. So fish farming is a big part of the commercial fishery in the Pacific. There are hatcheries that release all of these small salmon to sea. So it's a different picture from Atlantic. But absolutely, there's something happening to the Pacific salmon. It may be different to what's happening to the Atlantic salmon. I've highlighted that the answer lies in the middle of the North Atlantic, which is very difficult to research, whether there's something similar or something quite different to Pacific salmon. But clearly, all salmonoid species in the Northern Hemisphere are in a terrible state. And the more collaborative research that can be done with various institutions in Canada, in the United States, and in all the European countries, the better. Absolutely. And Scotland should play its very full part in that.
Okay, thanks.
Just finally, the salmon farming industry would suggest that there's a disproportionate focus on aquaculture and specifically salmon farming in relation to the decline of wild salmon. And you've made clear today that there's quite a number of different factors which are affecting the population of Atlantic salmon. Are we in this situation because salmon farming is an easy target? And actually, if we want to address the issues with wild salmon, we need to be realistic and look at all the challenges and not focus specifically, as some would suggest this committee is doing, too much on aquaculture, not on the other issues that are facing the species.
Yes, I think so. I think there's a huge sense of disappointment from the Interactions Working Group that There was this focus, and quite rightly so, on the interaction between wild salmon and fish farming, but there are all of these other pressures that really haven't been addressed and haven't been looked at. And I think that the to some extent, people can see fish farms. You know, when they drive up and down the west coast of Scotland, they see fish farms. They're very obvious. They're very there, and people say, well, you know, there's bound to be some impact there. Nobody can see the 4 million tonnes of mackerel biomass that's swimming between Iceland, Greenland and Faroe. Vociferous appetite, and you know, how many smolts does 4 million tonnes of mackerel biomass eat in a year? They didn't used to be there. Climate change has pushed them north into the area where salmon feed. They used to be located much further south in Europe. So that's probably, in my view, the main reason, but it's out of sight and it's out of mind and very difficult to ascertain. And fish farming is, of course, very obvious and very much in people's sight.
Thank you very much, John. That's been a hugely helpful session. I wish you a safe flight back to Shetland, and thank you for taking that journey down to join us today in person. That's very much appreciated. We'll now suspend the meeting for 10 minutes to allow a changeover in witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back. And we will now hear from Fisheries Management Scotland to continue our discussion around wild salmon populations in Scotland. And joining us, we have Dr. Alan Wells, the Chief Executive from Fisheries Management Scotland. So welcome, Alan. We have approximately an hour for this session. So I'm going to kick off once again with a nice, simple opener. What is your broad assessment on progress made in implementing the recommendations of the REC Committee and also the Salmon Interactions Working Group reports?
Well, thanks very much for inviting me to committee today, and it's great to be here in person. Really appreciate the opportunity. Pretty similar to what John said, actually. I think it's pretty disappointing that there's been such a lack of progress across the two reports. I sat on the Salmon Interactions Working Group. I thought it was a really good process. I thought it was a really useful process, and it had the potential to take us quite a long way further in dealing with some of these issues. I actually think it was an excellent example of collaboration between the wild and farm sectors. As John said, after a slow start, we got the right people around the table with a shared determination to come up with recommendations designed to improve the situation. If you'd said to me before that process that we'd reach unanimous agreement on 42 recommendations, I might not have believed you, but we did that. Whilst I'm not arguing that that final report was perfect, I'm strongly of the view that once delivered, those recommendations would improve the situation greatly. And unfortunately, the Scottish Government has not really taken the opportunity to act on the majority of those recommendations, despite an initial positive response to the report. So it's pretty disappointing.
So given that your recommendations had unanimous support, that would suggest there was nothing which was unreasonable. There was no unreasonable ask of government or the industry to implement those recommendations. Why do you think we have seen such a poor response to the recommendations and poor progress? Is it lack of resources? Is it lack of ambition? What's your views on why we've made little or no progress on most of the recommendations?
I think there's a number of things kind of mixed into all of that, really, and it's not really an easy question to answer. Obviously, there are things that happened outside everyone's control. We had the COVID pandemic that came about just around about the time that the Interactions Working Group was report was published. So obviously, there were a series of issues and more important things in many people's view that needed to be taken forward, but I think we've also seen, some pushback from on some of those things as well. I think there have been barriers to delivery of both the REC report and the Salmon Interactions Working Group, and I think they fall into really three categories: the sort of lack of a holistic assessment of the regulatory system in the round, and I think you've seen lots of examples of that as you've had evidence from other people. I think there remains a lack of trust between the two sectors, and behaviours can be an issue as well, and I'm very happy to expand on those. So at the moment, regulation is very clear, I think, is disjointed, and we haven't fixed that issue. So you've heard from the Fish Health Inspectorate that only look at sea lice from a farm fish perspective, aren't looking at what it means from a wild fish perspective. We recommended through the Salmon Interactions Working Group that there should be a single regulator. We talked about that earlier on. There isn't a single regulator. SEPA have only been given powers on sea lice. We still don't have the escapes issue dealt with. It's a whole series of things that are not being dealt with holistically. There's a lack of trust, but I think that lack of trust also is partly to do with the fact that we're not operating within a regulatory framework that facilitates those sort of discussions that John was mentioning earlier on. It's not reasonable to expect one small sector and one very large sector to kind of sort these things out between themselves. It needs to be done within a suitable framework for that to happen. There's a whole series of things going on, and that requires leadership, and it requires to be taken forward at a national level to deliver that framework within which those sort of discussions can take place.
We heard from some witnesses almost back patting to say there was no overlap. That doesn't tie up with a holistic approach or a joined up thinking. It sounds like it's very much silo working. Is that one of the issues we have with SEPA and NatureScot or whoever, not actually working together and no overlap, so they're not, as you say, looking at the holistic approach?
I'm not sure it's quite as black and white as that. I think the regulators do get together quite regularly and they do work, but they're trying to deliver some of these things within regulatory structures and frameworks that maybe aren't best designed for this. The marine environment's an incredibly dynamic and complex environment. We plan fish farms using a terrestrial planning system that's just simply not designed for that purpose. SEPA's trying to use the controlled activities regulations to deliver the farm fish health framework. I'm sure we'll come on to some of the reasons why the sea lice risk framework. And I'm sure we'll come on to some of that a little bit later on. But we also try to address issues in silos. One of the things that this committee and the REC committee were very interested in was the degree of mortalities within the farm fish sector. Now, that's not, strictly speaking, a big issue for us. We're more interested in sea lice and escapes. But by looking at farm fish health through the farm fish health framework, without considering what that means to the wider environment or to wild fish, you're only looking at one small part of the problem in isolation. We have to look at it in a much more holistic manner if we're going to deal with these issues properly.
Thanks very much. We'll move on to our first theme, which is research and collaboration. A question from Eleanor Whittle.
Good morning, Dr. Wells. The REC committee report noted scientific uncertainties regarding the impact of farmed salmon on wild salmon populations. And we've heard some, a bit about that this morning. We've asked, I think, in every session we've had, about the uncertainties, because we know that it's a complex picture as to what is actually impacting so greatly on the wild salmon. Has scientific understanding improved at all since the REC report came out?
So as I say, we're operating in a pretty dynamic environment that's quite difficult to understand. But there is a lot of research there that is already there. Scottish Government published a summary of science in 2021, by no means a full literature review, but a summary of the relevant science. And there have been a number of literature reviews that have been taken forward in that area as well. The information is relatively clear that salmon farms have the ability to impact on wild fish, but that's not to say that that happens everywhere and on every location, at every location that there is a salmon farm. But what we do know from that data is that salmon farms are a much more important contributor of sea lice into the environment than wild fish are. Just to put that into some sort of context for you, one farm on the West Coast houses more farmed salmon than there are wild fish returning to the entire west coast of Scotland. So the actual number of fish which can be infested and therefore act as a reservoir of sea lice is way out of kilter from anything that we've seen in a natural perspective. What we've been doing with support from Scottish Government and through the environmental management plans is looking at sea trout in particular. It's very difficult to get wild salmon to sample them, because when they leave the rivers, they head off into the North Atlantic. Sea trout remain in coastal areas, so you can sample them. And that monitoring data, I think there was a question the other week, has been used and it's been analysed by Marine Scotland Science to understand the association of abundance of salmon lice colonising farmed salmon with the occurrence of salmon lice on wild trout. And that paper was only published this year, earlier on this year. And Marine Scotland found a significant positive association between adult female sea lice abundance on farms and juvenile salmon lice on wild trout, totally consistent with a causal relationship in which increases in the number of salmon lice on farmed fish cause an increase in salmon lice on wild trout. So, the information continues to come forward. There's a pretty clear scientific consensus that there is the potential for an impact on wild fish from sea lice on farmed fish, and that's before we get onto escapes and genetic integration. But the reality is we don't currently know exactly where, if you put a farm in a particular location, what that will mean for a particular population of wild fish. And I think that's where the sea lice framework does have the opportunity to really address some of those evidence gaps and give us a much greater understanding although we'd much rather see that come forward a lot quicker than it's planned to at the moment.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. I've got a question around, so recommendation 44 was about the that there's mechanisms to encourage collaboration between the sectors, and that should be further developed and introduced. And it also recommends that the Scottish Government's Wild Salmon Interaction Group should, as part of its work, address this matter as a priority. So I'd be interested to understand if you have a sense that there's been any improvement in terms of collaboration, this kind of transparency aspect, so collaboration and the information sharing between the two sectors since 2018. And if you've got any examples of good practice, that would be great to hear.
So John mentioned examples of collaboration and shared working at a local level, and that's not actually new. That was happening before 2018 as well. What we were talking about in the Salmon Interactions Working Group, and I guess what the REC report was talking about, was formal mechanisms that would help to facilitate that. And I'm afraid that hasn't really moved forward to any great extent. What we have done is quite a lot of work at a local level. So we had some funding from Crown Estate Scotland to look at new methods of monitoring sea lice on wild fish. And one of the ways we did that was using coastal fight nets, which are similar to the sort of commercial nets that salmon commercial fisheries used to use. And that allows you to sample sea trout. They swim around in the net, you can sample them and release them, and it's a very low impact way of sampling those fish. Those nets are big and unwieldy, so we needed help to get them into the water, and the fish farm companies locally were a fantastic help in doing that. They provided boats and they provided personnel not only to get those nets into the water, but also to go along with the biologists so that when they were looking at the lice on the fish farmers were also seeing the lice on the fish, and it gave them a much clearer understanding of what was going on. So that was a really beneficial and useful way of going about things. We also have environmental management plans, which are a condition of planning. And through those environmental management plans, very often there is wild fish monitoring as part of that process. And again, that's led to discussions happening at a local level. One of the problems that we've had, though, is taking those discussions and turning them into actions on the ground. And what we really want to see happening at a local level is having a forum for engagement where concerns are genuinely listened to and addressed and acted upon. And that's what's missing at the moment.
And in terms of that forum, so that's that formal mechanism that you were asking for. Who should take that forward?
Well, I think all of these things can usefully be delivered as part of a reformed regulatory system. The mechanism that we had through the environmental management plans was that those EMPs, those environmental management plans, required there to be an end of cycle review meeting where the performance on the farm fish and what was happening on the wild fish were discussed. And the idea was to look at what was happening and try and come up with means of ensuring that if there were any issues, they didn't happen in the next production cycle. I think that could easily be built into a regulatory system. I think that could be built into SEPA's new sea lice framework.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Kavina.
Rhoda Grant.
Can I ask about climate change and what consideration that has been given into the impact of wild salmon numbers? And we heard earlier about Norway closing rivers for salmon fishing to protect salmon numbers. Is that something we should be considering?
So two questions there, really. Certainly from the perspective of climate change, that's a big impact on salmon. It's an impact at sea, and it's an impact in our rivers as well. We have a situation where in 2018, I think it was, around about 70% of Scottish rivers reached a temperature which is where stress starts to act on salmon. So climate change is acting on our wild salmon populations now. In terms of how we address that, within rivers, we're doing a lot of work through our membership, the District Salmon Fishery Boards and the Fishery Trust, to plant trees next to rivers to provide cooling shade. And that can reduce the temperatures of the rivers by a few degrees to help keep them below these really difficult thresholds. At sea, it's a completely different scenario for us. So what we have to focus on are the impacts on wild salmon that we can address. And that includes sea lice and it includes escapes, but it also includes things like pollution, barriers to migration, and a whole series of other things. So we're looking at all of those things in the round. We have a wild salmon strategy in Scotland. I don't know if John was aware of that earlier on. We also have a delivery plan, and that's looking at a whole wide range of pressures that wild salmon face. So there isn't a focus purely on salmon farming from our perspective. You also mentioned that in Norway some rivers have closed, and you know, certainly with the IUCN designating Atlantic salmon across GB as endangered, I suspect that's something that, you know, many people may wonder why angling is permitted on an endangered species. But it's also important to recognise that we need to avoid unintended consequences from any action we take. Anglers have been leading the way for many years when it comes to salmon conservation through a range of voluntary measures and self-imposed behaviour changes to ensure that their actions are carried out responsibly. So that includes changes to gear types, practice of catch and release, and in Scotland 98% of fish are returned, which is the highest level of any party to the North Atlantic Salmon Conservation Organisation. And we also voluntarily cease fishing at times of high water temperatures. Not only that, anglers are the eyes and ears on our rivers and regularly report illegal fishing, pollution incidents, invasive species. Indeed, if we didn't have anglers on our rivers, we wouldn't have known that we had invasive pink salmon in our rivers a few years ago. And we rely on anglers to deal with that. So while the IUCN have designated Atlantic salmon as endangered, they also recognised in their accompanying information the work that both we as Fisheries Management Scotland, we were name-checked, but also our members and anglers are doing to make things better. So, yes, you can call for the cessation of angling, but it won't address the issues and the conservation issues facing Atlantic salmon. And in the case of illegal fishing, it may actually make things worse, because if you don't have anglers on the banks of the rivers, then experience from Ireland and other places where fishing has been banned on some rivers is that illegal fishing goes up massively. Just to put it into some sort of context, the best end estimate of the impact that angling might have on Atlantic salmon is that it might result in a loss of under 1% of the population. So if the committee genuinely feels that there is a threshold for ceasing activity that's as low as 1%, there's an awful lot more activities across Scotland that wouldn't be happening in Scotland either.
You quoted a figure of salmon returns. Was it 97%, did you say? Is that adult salmon or is that smolts?
Sorry,
that doesn't seem to fit with...
That's adult salmon which are caught by rod and line and then released back into the river to continue their spawning migration.
Okay, so not smolts, though?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Just before we move on from research and collaboration, can I ask... Everything seems to revolve around sea lice and the impact of potentially an increased sea lice load on the wild salmon. Is there any research done to look at the impacts of the use of chemicals or the use of antibiotics or the biomass that's created with fish farms and how that might impact on wild salmon? And is that is the impact significant and something that we should be looking at other than focusing on sea lice?
So our focus is on sea lice and escapes primarily at the moment. We do pay attention to what's happening in terms of things like gill health or mortality or other disease things, but we don't really have a good enough understanding at the moment about the potential for that to impact on wild salmonids. In many cases, those are issues for the farm fish. We know from discussions that we've had with the industry that in some cases it's only an individual pen that's impacted by some of these things. So we're certainly not complacent about it, but you know, we've got significant issues to deal with across sea lice and escape. So that's our primary focus at the moment.
Okay, thank you. So we're now moving on to sea lice regulatory reform, and a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Dr. Wells. First of all, can I ask, is your organisation happy that SEPA are the lead agency?
Yeah, I think we're comfortable that SEPA are the the lead agency, but you know, I think there are elements of the sea lice framework that we have concerns about, but there are also elements that we're really quite positive about. So I'm happy to discuss both of those.
Yes, I was looking for examples of what you might have deemed positive or negative in terms of that designation of responsibility.
Well, first of all, it's very helpful indeed to have a single regulator who's responsible for the impacts of sea lice on wild fish. That's been a massive gap in the regulatory system for the last 50 years. It's been a gap that we've been flagging up. I think I've sat in front of various committees of the Scottish Parliament flagging that up since 2012 when the Aquaculture and Fisheries Bill was going through Parliament. So it's great that there's a single regulator. It would be even better if that single regulator also dealt with escapes and everything else to do with wild fish, but one step at a time. We think that the framework, now that it's in place, will help to steer developments away from areas of high risk. So I think that's a good thing. It will introduce additional reporting requirements on the number of fish and lice, increasing transparency and enabling a better understanding of the total lice number. And crucially, and I think this is something that's maybe hasn't come through as strongly as I might have liked in previous sessions, the sea lice risk framework recognises that it's the total number of infective stage lice in the environment that's important to wild fish. It's not the average of number of lice per farm fish that's important. That's pretty irrelevant to wild fish, because you can double production and stay at the same number of lice per farmed fish, but the number of lice in the environment is massively greater. So we have to look at this holistically. We have to look at the total number of lice in the environment. And we have to also remember that these lice are planktonic. So where you have an impact is not necessarily where the farm is. There's a period of days before they reach the infective stage, and CEPA are looking at that through their modelling to try and understand where those impacts will happen.
Well, if I can just pick you up on you know, the various witnesses that we've had, some organisations are not happy that CEPA have the capability to effectively regulate wild and farmed fish interactions. I just wondered if you, although you're quite positive about the responsibility in terms of sea lice that CEPA have and that single as a single lead body, do you have concerns that they don't have the capability to effectively regulate?
So we were very strongly in favour of the Salmon Interactions Working Group recommendation that the framework going forward should be robust, transparent, enforceable and enforced. And those are the tests that we will use to assess that thing, that process. And when we responded to the two consultations on the Salmon Interactions Working Group, we tested it against those principles and we felt that it fell short. And you've heard some of the reasons from other stakeholders as to why that was, but I can give you some of those reasons now. So the approach is based on a number of wild salmon protection zones in which the number of lice needs to be managed, but it doesn't take a cumulative approach. Wild fish passes through a wild salmon protection zone, but it may pass several others on its way to sea. And it's only that first wild salmon protection zone nearest the Natal River that's actually being assessed. I think that's a big issue. It doesn't apply wild salmon protection zones in all relevant areas. So there are some rivers that historically had salmon populations, which no longer have salmon populations. We should be looking to get those salmon populations back. So we should be having areas in those areas. And also some of those zones don't make intuitive sense to us. So just to give you an example, we've got fish coming out of an SAC river in the Loch Lomond system, the River Endrick, will pass through a wild salmon protection zone. If they come down the coast of Ayrshire, they'll go through little semicircles around the river mouths, but we're not protecting that migration route of fish, which is coming down that area. So I think they need to be looked at again. Sorry, did you want to come in?
Is that what you meant by a sort of holistic approach or case-by-case approach? And does that mean that this committee should be ultimately recommending that the REC recommendations are updated to reflect that?
potentially, I mean, that's one part of a holistic approach. I think that's a much bigger thing. We've got different parts of government and different agencies looking at different elements of regulation, and those elements of regulation don't always align with each other. So you've already heard about the inherent tension of what you need to do in terms of sea lice control to protect farm fish health, and that being extremely different from what you need to do to protect wild fish health, because the point at which wild fish are infected, or when it's a problem that they're infected with sea lice, is when their smolts leaving the rivers, and a smolt can't handle a large number of lice like an adult salmon can on a fish farm. So, you know, there are inherent tensions between what we're trying to do in different parts of the regulatory system. The other weaknesses in terms of the framework or the concerns that we have is that the relative risk assessment that CEPA has carried out is based on self-reported data from the industry, but only extends back a few years. Mm. So it's only 2 or 3 years that they've used. Does that give you enough information to really understand what the situation is with sea lice? And it's also important to note that that CEPA assessment is based on everything working as it should. It's not based on a worst-case scenario where lice do get out of control. So there's a big difference, as I said, between managing sea lice numbers well for the purpose of farm fish health, and that's the basis on which the sea lice data is collected currently through the Fish Health Inspectorate, and sea lice management for the protection of wild fish. And we also talked earlier on about the timeline. We're extremely concerned about the sort of five-year timeline, which it will be likely to take to determine whether sea lice limits are appropriate or not, and that will take. Yeah, and that means that some farms that may be causing an impact now will continue to cause an impact for the next 5 years, and that standstill condition that CEPA use only relates to the number of lice that are on the farms, but it's based on 2 or 3 years' worth of lice counts.
Okay, I just want to make a comment that I do find it very difficult as a committee member to understand the interaction myself between the responsibilities of the Fish Health Inspectorate, Nature Scot, local authority and other bodies that are making key decisions that actually it seems as though are underneath this single regulatory board. And I personally would like to see more clarity around how all of those organisations interact, because it seems at the moment that certain organisations, can I say as strongly as blame others for certain areas that they don't have responsibility for. And I just wondered if that was a fair assessment.
I don't know if it's, there's definitely some people will blame other people more than others. I think most people involved in the regulation of the industry are trying to do a good job, but they're trying to do a good job with one hand tied behind their back because they've only got powers for certain things. So when Charles Allen was telling you about sea lice from the Fish Health Inspectorate, he was speaking from the context of the powers that he has and the approach that he takes. That's very different from what you might do if you were trying to protect wild fish from sea lice. So I don't know where blame sits in all that, but essentially the regulatory system that we have at the moment is not fit for purpose, and we need to fix it, and we need to fix it fast.
Thank you.
Emma Roddick.
Thanks, Convener. It was interesting there, the comments around the importance to wild salmon being the number of sea lice, not the number of sea lice per fish, and it seems that then it would follow that as the industry grows, the risk to wild salmon is greater. Do we need to see better management of lice within a farmed atmosphere before growth can be justified?
So I think that's what the sea lice risk framework is designed to do. So the sea lice risk framework is designed to keep sea lice concentrations below a threshold that was derived in Norway that we know is potentially an impact on wild fish within those areas. So if sea lice within those wild salmon protection zones is already at that level, then our expectation is that there would be no further development in that area using open net pen technology. It might be that you can use other technologies to develop there. You could do something in close containment or something else, but that's our understanding. So it's about managing the overall number of infective stage lice in the environment at a level which is not going to cause impacts to wild fish. In a previous life, I worked at the University of St Andrews as a postdoctoral research fellow, and the work that I was doing there was on interactions between wild and farmed fish. And we derived threshold levels of lice that cause problems for wild fish. So there's good information, so we know where we need to keep levels to. But the problem is we're working in this very complex and dynamic environment where those lice can move, you know, up to 30 kilometres before they reach the infective stage. So you need to understand where that interaction takes place. You need to understand where the fish are. We're working with colleagues in the Atlantic Salmon Trust and indeed Marine Directorate to understand fish movements through the coastal environment to a much greater extent as well. But it's a complex situation that we're trying to deal with.
There's the work that you did in line with the work in Norway, which sets the sort of number of lice, the capacity. Which is impactful. Do you align on that?
Yeah, I mean, there are, like with anything, there are slight difference between the two, but they're in broad alignment. The project I was working on was an EU-funded grant in Norway, Scotland and Ireland, so we were working closely with the same researchers that were doing that work.
Apologies, Emma, do you want to come back in?
Yeah, that's okay, Convener. Just very briefly, I'm wondering then, given the evidence that we've heard is that lice numbers per fish, except in circumstances where it has been admitted that it is high, out of control, needs work, it's fairly consistent. Is it more realistic to aim for fewer lice per fish or to tackle that interaction between lice in farmed salmon and wild salmon?
I think you need to look at all parts of the. You can take action at different parts of this. So, the idea would be to keep the overall lice number in the environment below a threshold that would be protective of wild fish. If you can't achieve that, then there are certain things you can do. You can reduce that lice threshold, but you can also reduce the biomass. SEPA have the power to do that, and as you heard at a previous session, they've done that in a number of cases, largely in relation to benthic impacts. The same powers would apply to the sea lice risk framework. So there's lots of different levers that you can use, but ultimately what we need to see is that the impacts of aquaculture are kept at a level which is protective of wild fish. Because we can have a situation, I genuinely believe we can have a situation where we can have an important salmon farming industry in Scotland and thriving wild fish populations working together. But to do that, we need to look at it holistically.
Sorry, Convener, can I just clarify one final point?
Certainly.
Just around that then, thinking about the lice and where they are in high numbers, do you think enough actions such as reducing biomass that you mentioned are being taken in those circumstances now, or does there need to be more enforcement and reaction to growing numbers?
So it's really important to recognise that until February this year, we simply didn't have a regulatory system that managed sea lice impacts on wild fish. So no, we haven't had any of that, but nor would I have expected to at this stage, because the way that SEPA have brought the farm fish sea lice framework into play is that the initial focus is on new farms. So it would only be new farms that would be under the framework until next year. Next year, we'll start the process of looking at existing farms. But unfortunately, as I said earlier on, that's due to take a 5-year timescale. So it's going to be a while before, you know, under the current timescales, we expect any of these things to happen, which I think is really unfortunate, because there is good information out there that we could be using in the meantime.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Convener, just picking up on what you mentioned a couple of times about SEPA with the 5-year approach to looking at the data and monitoring the situation, the REC committee and the working group reports recommended the need for a precautionary approach to mitigate any impacts of sea lice infestation on wild salmon. And I'd be interested to get a sense from you if you think that the sea lice risk framework applies a precautionary approach, given, and we've already heard about the 5 years, but maybe there's some other aspects of what they're doing there that you could share with us.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are areas of the sea lice framework which is precautionary, and there are other areas which aren't. So it's a little bit of a curate's egg in that respect, I guess. But you know, from our perspective, we're not focused entirely on the precautionary principle. We're focused on the environmental principles more generally. So that's the principle of protecting the environment and integrating that into the making of policies, the polluter pays principle, the prevention principle, and the rectification at source principle. So across the piece, I would say that there are issues with the framework as it's currently designed in a number of those. So we talked about the timeline that's being required, and the fact that in the meantime, all CEPA are intending to do is have these standstill conditions. Now, those standstill conditions relate to the number of farmed lice per fish, and it's just keeping things at a level. I don't believe that's precautionary. We also are not dealing with sea trout in the first instance, and again, that's more complicated because of the sea trout's life cycle, but again, that's something that could be coming forward in a more precautionary way to make sure that we understand and mitigate those issues on sea trout. But at the REC committee, just to give you an example, Professor James Braun from Stirling University gave evidence that in the past some farms had an average of 100 lice per fish. Doesn't take into account those historic impacts. You know, we talked about rivers that are lacking salmon and things like that earlier on. So the committee may want to consider whether the polluter pays principle should apply to those sort of historic impacts as well. Because we only really have good data for a few years, which is really unfortunate, but we're in a very different situation than the situation they have in Norway.
Colin Beattie. Okay.
Thanks. I asked the question about no deterioration earlier in the previous panel. But so CEPA says it can prevent deterioration of wild salmon populations by allowing the highest risk farms to continue to have sea lice levels as high as their recent levels rather than reducing them. And I'd be interested to get a sense from you what you think, if you think that will prevent wild salmon numbers falling due to sea lice.
It really depends what the lice levels are now, where those lice go and all the rest of it. And we don't know enough to answer that question in precisely the way that you might like me to. But I think we need to understand, and there is monitoring being put in place, and we're working with CEPA to develop those monitoring approaches. We need to understand what that means. We do lice monitoring across Scotland. We see sea lice on wild fish. We do not see impacts on wild fish everywhere there is fish farming. But equally, in some areas, we do see impacts on wild fish. And that's presumably under the current lice levels that there are on farms. So I suspect it's not precautionary enough, no.
Okay. And then just to come back to earlier, you were saying that that CEPA needs to be taking a cumulative approach. In the previous panel, I was hearing, and from CEPA, we're hearing that they're taking more of a case-by-case approach. Could you just say a bit more about why you think it needs to be a cumulative approach?
So if you could have a situation where a salmon is leaving a river and moving into a wild salmon protection zone, and that lice levels in that zone, although under the level that CEPA would want to regulate to, are relatively high. They're quite close to that barrier. So by the time that fish reaches the end of the wild salmon protection zone, it has a burden of lice which is just under the threshold, which will cause it problems. To get to sea, it then has to pass through four or five other wild salmon protection zones, or even one other wild salmon protection zone, which also has lice levels which are elevated, and that would be enough to take that fish over a threshold. And if the lice levels are high enough, it will cause mortality.
So there's something about where we get the snapshot of information. We're not seeing the full experience of that fish.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
And that's something we've raised with CEPA regularly throughout the process.
Can I ask you to ask your final question in this group
as
well,
sure.
Please?
Yep. Yeah, so this one is around the way that data is presented. So the REC committee was recommendation number 22 recommended enhancement in the way that sea lice data is presented and called for a comprehensive and accessible reporting system. I'd be interested again to hear what you think about the way the data is currently presented. Is it comprehensive and accessible?
So we were really pleased after the REC committee that the sea lice reporting order has helped to increase transparency. So we have sea lice levels on a farm-by-farm basis, which I think I've been arguing for since I can remember. So that does help things a great deal. We also understand that CEPA will introduce lice reporting conditions, and we hope to see that will be a streamlined and simplified process that increases transparency. So the principle that we collect data once and use it multiple times is really sensible. I think that would be useful for both a farm fish health and wild fish conservation perspective. At the moment, that sea lice is published on Scotland's aquaculture website. It's not particularly accessible. When we take that information off there, we have to put it through Excel and actually put it into a format that makes it useful to look at it on a farm-by-farm basis over time. It's not that difficult to do, but it's an extra step that shouldn't really be necessary.
So what would make it more accessible?
Well, I think the Barents Watch systems come up a number of times in discussion in Norway. It's an expensive system, but it would be well worth having all of that information in one place. Just to give you another example, the sea lice data, and again, partly because of COVID, partly because of cyber attacks within CEPA, sits on a different part of the Scotland's Aquaculture website than the other data. And until recently, there wasn't a single field of information that was common between the two data sets. So you couldn't actually look at sea lice in relation to biomass or any of the other information that's out there. So, you know, you want to be able to look at that information in the round so that you can get a holistic understanding of what's happening.
And that seems to be an important part of what we're trying to do here in terms of even the collaboration we were talking about earlier, different sectors working together. Yeah. We've got the information, everyone has access to it, then we're all looking at the same picture, yeah.
Absolutely. And, I think we've talked about that collaboration and we want to see that happening. We want to work with the industry, but we want to do that framed within a fit-for-purpose regulatory system. So it's not our job to fix the issues. It's our job to actually work together and actually try and come up with innovative solutions that make things even better.
Thanks.
We're now going to move on to our third theme on escapes and a question from Emma Roddick. I beg your pardon. I've jumped Colin. My apologies. Back to Colin on sea lice regulator reform. Colin.
Thank you, Mayor. Alan, twice you've mentioned about the regulatory system and used the phrase not fit for purpose. So let me ask you just a direct question on that. The Salmon Interactions Working Group report recommended that the reformed regulatory system should be fully resourced, meet the tests of being robust, transparent, enforceable and enforced. Have these tests been met?
No. So it remains to be seen in terms of the sea lice framework. We operate across a whole range of pressures that wild salmon face, and we do have concerns about CEPA's approach to enforcement in particular. I think they tend to be quite reluctant to go down an enforcement route, so we would like to see that happening. I think the example came up of agriculture and how CEPA deal with agriculture and have those discussions at a local farm level. I think that was entirely appropriate in the first round of river basin management planning. I think it was potentially appropriate in the second round of river basin management planning, but we're into the third round of river basin management plans now, and there's still quite a lack of enforcement in terms of meeting general binding rules for agriculture. We see issues elsewhere as well. So, you know, we will continue to look at those tests that you mentioned there and assess the regulation of sea lice against that, but also the regulation that CEPA does across its regulatory remit, because we are in the middle of a biodiversity crisis now. It's not just about wild salmon, it's about our environment more generally. We can't keep doing the same things and expecting a different result.
You talk about enforcement. Are you aware how many times CEPA has taken out any sort of enforcement action in recent times?
In relation to wild-farmed interactions or more generally?
Oh, in connection with sea lice and generally.
Well, the sea lice framework only came into play in February, so there's been no enforcement action by CEPA whatsoever. But I wouldn't have expected there to have been by this stage, to be honest.
Do you regard the regulatory system to be transparent?
Not in all cases. I think one of the issues we have with the sea lice framework is the way in which regulation against sea lice will take place. So I think the REC committee had a recommendation about the number of thresholds there are for sea lice and how it was confusing and all the rest of it. CEPA are intending to use a rolling average of sea lice over a period of weeks to determine whether sea lice thresholds have been breached. I think that's going to be utterly impossible for stakeholders who are interested in this to understand, and I think it fails on the transparency test.
Okay, thank you very much. Back to you, Convener.
And we now indeed move on to escapes. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Has there been sufficient progress made by the Scottish Government and its agencies in reducing the instances of escapes?
No, but it depends what you mean by your question, I guess. I mean, the incidence of escapes have gone down. But I think we should put that into some sort of context. At the moment, it's not illegal to have an escape. It's only illegal not to report that you've had an escape or not to report a circumstance that may have led to an escape. So there is no basis for dealing with this issue. And as John Goodlad said earlier on, it was agreed in the Salmon Interactions Working Group that appropriate fines should apply. And they should be proportionate to the incident and scale of the escape, and that those sanctions should be invested in wild salmon conservation work. So the incidence of escapes has gone down, and the number of escape fish has reduced markedly over the years in terms of what's been reported. But we also operate a reporting app for suspected fish farm escapes. Now, anyone can feed into that app. But of the last 55 reports submitted, 52 were made by District Salmon Fishery Boards and Fishery Trusts, so people with the expertise to identify and tell the difference between a farmed and wild salmon, which not everyone can do. But with freshwater escapes, which are a particular issue from our perspective, there's really no ambiguity because they have a vaccination mark on their belly, so it's very easy to see those to tell those fish apart. So with that in mind, self-reported data that FHI collects indicates that there have been no freshwater escapes since the year 2020, but that's simply not the case. And we've got evidence from 18 reports where escaped juveniles have been identified between 2022 and as recently as the 1st of May this year. So it's an ongoing issue, and there's a big difference between reported escapes and what we actually find in the rivers. And the numbers that we have will be an underestimate, because you won't catch all of them in any way, shape or form.
And as you say, escapes must be reported. So where do you think the fall down has been there? Obviously, people not reporting, but in terms of that officially then being reacted to, enforced, what needs to change?
So I guess it depends on whether the fish farm is aware that there's been an escape. You know, if there's been something that's happened that they've not been aware of, or a few fish have got out because a tube hasn't been. I'm not a fish farmer, so I don't know the specific ways in which that might happen. Then there's a possibility that fish get into the wild for those sort of reasons. In freshwater, it appears to be a particular issue. And if I can give you just one example from the Kyla Sutherland, I think it is a lack of regulation. So the idea of what the Salmon Interactions Working Group was suggesting was that there should be a licence condition on all fish farm licences which meets our international requirements under NASCO, and that is to maintain 100% of farm fish within the farms. Now, that doesn't exist at the moment. So what we have is a situation where conditions have come through, things like planning, instead, to try and address these issues. So we have an experience, for example, where a condition through an environmental management plan for the protection of wild salmonids hasn't been followed through at all. So in Loch Shin, in the Kyla Sutherland, there's a farm that's been in breach of a planning condition to have an EMP for 6 years now. The planning condition in question is designed to assess and ultimately address risks to local wild fish populations, and it's extremely concerning that still no action has been taken despite evidence of escapes of farm fish occurring on an annual basis. And that evidence has been substantiated by Marine Scotland Science, who have done genetic samples not only on the wild fish but on both of the farms operating on Loch Shin, and they've identified that those fish came from both farms.
Okay, thank you. I'm interested then in, obviously we've been talking a lot about penalties for fish escapes, what farms can be doing to prevent that from happening, and where you see the line between escapes that were not preventable and, say, negligence or liability, because if we are thinking that some farms are having escapes and not even realising, that does point to a more concerning picture than simply a storm has torn a net.
Yeah, I mean, I would emphasise I don't know why those, you know, the circumstances in which those farm fish were in the environment, but I am quite concerned that some of the discussions that we've had around escapes and the way that they're regulated or indeed not regulated currently is discussed as if escapes are inevitable and are an acceptable outcome. And as if it's unreasonable to expect zero escapes. There doesn't appear to be a clear position across any of the public bodies regarding how escapes should be handled. So you've heard that FHI have powers to ensure that farmers are taking the appropriate measures to mitigate for escapes, yet escapes still happen. Planning authorities often scope fish escapes into environmental impact assessments, and then in answering that, farmers talk about how they'll mitigate against the risk of escapes to get their planning consent approved, and escapes still happen. It's clear that mitigation is not working, as escapes are still recorded. So does Scotland take a position that escapes are inevitable and acceptable? We know farmers don't want to have escapes. You know, it's, as John said earlier on, it's not in their interest to lose fish. So it's difficult to understand what the process that FHI have and what the environmental impact assessments are doing if we know that those mitigations don't prevent escapes happening. But what we do know, thanks to work done by the Scottish Government in 2021 that was mentioned earlier on, is that in all areas where fish farming occurs, genetic integration has been identified. So that's farm genes turning up in wild fish populations. So is it Scotland's position that the evidenced impact of escapes, because that is an impact on wild salmon, is also acceptable? I don't believe that is the case, and I certainly don't believe it should be the case. So we need a system in Scotland that enables salmon farming and thriving wild salmon populations to occur in harmony. And this issue around escapes is a clear example where we haven't moved away from the status quo at all.
And just picking up there, you mentioned the Fish Health Inspectorate asking farms to take appropriate measures. Do you think there's enough clarity and agreement on what appropriate measures are? You know, do you know what appropriate measures are, and would your position be the same as the Fish Health Inspectorate, individual farms, Marine Scotland?
So we have a Scottish technical containment standard in Scotland. It's pretty out of date, and our understanding is that the existing standard is that the industry is essentially using a Norwegian standard. It is being updated at the moment, but genuinely don't believe we should be regulating based on process. I'm not a fish farmer. I'm not an engineer. There are lots of people out there who are far better placed to tell you about what needs to be done to contain fish within a fish farm, but I'm sure it's absolutely possible to do that if there's enough investment and enough effort put into doing that. What we need to regulate on, particularly from a wild fish perspective, is on environmental outcomes. And if farmed salmon are getting out of these cages and interbreeding with wild fish, that is a poor environmental outcome, and it is something that needs to be addressed. But I don't know how that should be addressed from an engineering or a fish farming perspective, but we should be focusing on outcomes, not on process. And that would be my view on regulation across the board.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Just finally then, I wonder if you agree with the Fish Health Inspectorate that the salmon farming industry has a good record on containment.
I think that's probably the case if you look at containment from the perspective of farmed fish and farming farmed fish. If you look at it from the perspective of what's happening in the wild fish population, and what the work that's been done by the Marine Directorate has shown, we know that genetic material from farm strains are present in wild populations pretty much everywhere that there is fish farming going on, including in East Coast rivers where there is smolt production within those rivers. Everywhere where there isn't fish farming essentially has very little genetic integration. And as I understand it, the Marine Directorate use really quite conservative means of measuring that genetic integration as well. So it will be a minimum situation. That data was collected using an entirely unbiased survey system. It was those samples were taken by Fisheries Trust all the way across Scotland through the National Electrofishing Programme, and the data was analysed by the Scottish Government. The data we have at the moment is from, I think, 2021. There are another 2 years of data that Marine Directorate have, which is under analysis. So that picture will develop over time as well.
Thank you.
Just before we move on, again, I touched on in the last session about it's about environmental outcomes. And in this instance, the prime objective in stopping escapes, other than the economic impact on it has on the farmers themselves, is to avoid this integration. What role do you think genetics plays in that, or fish breeding? And if we could stop the fish that are escaping being able to breed with the wild population, would that not knock it in the head, and would that not result in the best outcomes environmentally?
So the primary concern is genetic integration, but it's not the only concern. So I think it would go a long way to addressing those things. But, you know, we have rainbow trout farmed in Scotland. Rainbow trout can't breed in the wild. Mm-hmm. And yet, if you get a big escape from rainbow trout, and we've had a number of those over the years, they can swamp habitat, they can cause all sorts of issues for wild fish, they can outcompete and things like that. And farmed salmon would fall into the same category. What we have noticed, you know, in the past, maybe sort of 10 or 20 years ago, if we had an escape in a local salmon farm, we would be expecting to see large number of escape farm fish within rivers. That doesn't appear to be as apparent now as it was in the past. We had a big escape a few years ago where it was the case, but in most cases we're not seeing large numbers of farm salmon within our rivers. Now that may be to do with the way that the farm fish are being bred, I don't know. But regardless of the fact we're not seeing large numbers in rivers, we are still seeing genetic integration, as we've mentioned a couple of times.
Okay, thanks very much. Eleanor Whittam.
Convener, and I must say I found everything you've just said there to be quite fascinating, and I think it's answered some of the questions that we've been asking all along. Following on from the questions around about escapes, I have a couple of questions around about sanctions. So notwithstanding the desire to have 100% containment, the REC committee report noted that the strict sanctions in Norway and recommended that appropriate sanctions should be developed and introduced in Scotland. Do you consider the current sanctions on escapes to be appropriate, or do you think we should have more stricter measures in place?
No, we don't consider them to be appropriate. The Salmon Interactions Working Group made a similar recommendation. We said that there should be fines proportionate to the size of the escape, and that those fines should be ring-fenced and spent on wild salmon conservation. I can't remember, sorry, whether it was yourself or not, but made reference to, sorry, I think it was Emma Roddick, made reference to Uru earlier on. My understanding was the context that we were talking about Uru was not so much in terms of recovering those escaped fish, but that was a mechanism by which those fines could be held, because obviously ring fencing fines in Scotland is not something that happens. Generally, fines go into the Scottish Consolidated Fund and go into sort of general taxation. So the reference to Uru was more about a mechanism by which those fines could be paid into somewhere and then put into wild salmon conservation projects.
You actually just answered the next two questions, because it was round about Uru. I wanted to understand how that actually worked in practice, and the fact that it is financed by industry and it's compulsory for farmers to be actually members of that. And I guess the final bit I did ask was going to ask was round about whether you're actually seeing any of that the ring fence sanctioned money going to where it's supposed to be going in terms of conservation.
Well, no, because there isn't any money coming in. So we need to have the fine system in place, or the licence conditions that would mean that there was an offence that would lead to a fine for that to happen. So not at this stage, no.
Thank you.
Thanks. Just before we move on to this, you touched on the fact that there was a discrepancy between what you understood to be the number of escapes in freshwater and those that were reported. However, there was a legal obligation to report escapes. When a river board or a river trust report finding farmed salmon in freshwater, but there is no report made by local fish farms, what understanding do you have of the regulatory body actually investigating that research to find out whether someone hasn't reported an escape when they were aware that actually took place?
So I can give you one example. In August 2020, a district salmon fishery board reported approximately 28 escaped juvenile farmed salmon to the Fish Health Inspectorate. They were genetically tested by the board as well. But the Fish Health Inspectorate didn't conduct a farm visit until November 2022, and still no audit report from the FHI has been shared with the District Salmon Fishery Board. So, you know, it's mixed. It's not what it should be, as far as we're concerned. And that would go across, again, regulation across the piece. We've got lots of people within our sector who report incidents of pollution or other things regularly. If people are going to take the time to do that, they want to understand what's happened on the back of it. I think that's only reasonable.
Yes, thank you. Okay, we move on to our final theme, which is consenting and planning, and a question from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I find it all very interesting hearing everybody's questions so far. One of the recommendations from the Rural Committee, recommendation number 41, recommended a precautionary approach to the siting of salmon farms to avoid migratory routes of wild salmon. And we've talked a little bit about migratory routes of wild salmon already, but does the siting of the new farms since 2018 indicate that a precautionary approach has been adopted, or have you seen any sites like close to migratory routes?
Yeah, I don't think that a precautionary approach has been adopted since 2018. I would hope that the sea lice framework will help with this process, because it is looking at these wild salmon protection zones in a spatial manner. And we've been doing work, as I said earlier on, to try and better understand what those migration routes might look like. I don't think it's a good analogy to think that wild salmon just follow very precise routes through the marine environment. We know it differs between years. It'll differ because of water conditions, wind forcing conditions and things like that. Sometimes fish coming out of Loch Linnhe go through the Sound of Mull. Other times they go south of Mull and round that way. And it will vary between years. So it's not as precise as saying, well, this is the migration route, that's what we need to protect. I think there are probably wild salmon in most areas of the Scottish coastal environment, but some areas will be more important than others, and those are the areas that, to be fair to SEPA, they're focused on by designating the wild salmon protection zones where they have designated them.
Have there been any fish farms relocated based on evidence of, you know, sea lice, or even, I mean, what was fascinating, you said earlier, like sea lice can move 30 kilometres before they find a host. It is pretty interesting hearing all about the, you know, the interaction with wild salmon and farm salmon. But I'm interested if there have been any sites relocated.
No, not that I'm aware of. But that's another example, actually, of where the holistic approach hasn't really taken place. So we've been developing, really, since the REC committee, the sea lice risk framework. In the Salmon Interactions Working Group, we had a recommendation that we should have a mechanism whereby biomass can be relocated from areas which are more sensitive to areas of which are less sensitive. Wouldn't it have been fantastic if we'd built that recommendation at the same time as we were dealing with the wild salmon the sea lice framework, so that if we did identify, for example, in the six areas that are seen by CIFA at the moment that are high risk, a mechanism for moving some of that biomass out of those quickly. Mm-hmm. So that's what I'll keep banging on about it, but we've not done this in a holistic way. We're doing it in a piecemeal approach. Mm-hmm. It's like playing whack-a-mole at the moment. Try and deal with something over here and something pops up elsewhere.
Just a wee find, it's a bit of a segue, but looking at, and I know Norway isn't the answer to everything and what Norway's doing in terms of research and development and sighting of pens, but I've been reading about these giant ships that are just, it's a big hull that is a floating fish farm that can be sighted in areas of deep water that can then resist storms and high waves. And is that something that we should be thinking about in terms of, instead of net pens that are fixed to the seabed, something other in looking at emerging technology?
I think we should be absolutely looking at emerging technology across the board. And indeed, the industry are doing that, particularly in Norway, because I think they're incentivized to look at it to a much greater extent over there. But I'm not an expert in what's happening in Norway. We know that some fish farmers in Scotland are looking at growing smolts to a larger size within closed containment, so that they only spend 1 year at sea. We look forward to seeing what the results of that, because we think that really has promised to reduce the impacts of sea lice on wild fish. We know that generally the impacts are worse in the second year of production than in the first year of production, for example. And there's been a lot of investment in Scotland on producing smolts in closed containment, and that's certainly something that I would like to see prioritised. I've mentioned already the really significant concerns we have about open net pen farming in freshwater lochs.
Okay, thanks.
Rachel Hamilton.
What is the process that allows your members to have a sufficient say in any consenting process?
So it's a real area of concern at the moment. District Salmon Fishery Boards are statutory consultees in the planning process, but we also have Nature Scot and now SEPA, and indeed Marine Directorate also respond. And often it doesn't feel, and it's quite frustrating to our members, it doesn't feel as if those concerns that are expressed by the statutory consultee that has responsibility for managing wild fisheries are taken as seriously as maybe some of those other issues. Now that we have the sea lice framework in place, we are working with the Scottish Government on developing the approach that all of the statutory consultees will take, and there's still a great deal of uncertainty in what that will look like going forward. So how's that going to fit? Is it SEPA's approach that's going to be taken? Nature Scot was talked about earlier on, have responsibility for the conservation of various species. They tend to focus only on areas which are SACs, either for wild salmon or for freshwater pearl mussels, which rely on salmon to complete their life cycle. But there's also another issue which you should probably be aware of in terms of the protection of wild salmon. It's not specific to fish farming, it's specific to really anything happening in the marine environment. And that is that salmon and sea trout are both priority marine features, so they're designated as priority marine features. But the only mechanism by which that can manifest itself is through one of the general policies in the National Marine Plan, which says that a development shouldn't impact the national status of a priority marine feature. I can't think of a single development that could happen in Scottish waters that could affect the national status of an Atlantic salmon population or a sea trout population. So essentially that protection is utterly meaningless. That needs to be addressed with urgency. Yeah. And that can then give Nature Scot, given that this is now an endangered species, a stronger role in that planning process as well.
Thank you for that. And just to be clear on the description of a national status of a species, how does that differ from recognising that a species could become endangered?
It's just the way that it's expressed in the National Marine Plan, to be honest with you. There's a list that's designated of what priority marine features are, and that's just the way that they're protected through the plan.
Okay. Can I ask you, earlier you talked about the monitoring that's going on through the app, the fish escapes, etc. Just out of interest, does that have any status in terms of the ability for some of your members to make a point about certain applications? Can they use that evidence?
Absolutely, it's in the public domain, and actually that information is shared directly with the Fish Health Inspectorate as well. They get an automatic update every time that there's a recording on the app. And we have a similar app for disease that's evident in wild fish, for pink salmon and for other things as well. So it's integrated into the process.
Yeah. Okay. How are the statutory consultees weighted in terms of where an application is granted? If, for example, I think what you have said is that it's about a salmon farm rather than the interaction between wild fish. So therefore, how does the weighting work in terms of that risk assessment?
So the conservation of wild salmon is a material condition, a material consideration in planning. So the local authorities have to take that into account when they're making their planning decision, alongside visual impact and all sorts of other things. And they have a biodiversity duty, so it does come into play. And we have environmental management plans that the local authorities have put in place to try and understand what's happening with wild fish, in recognition that there's this gap in the regulatory system, and to try and fill that gap. So it's not that they're completely that they're not part of the system, but I think everyone kind of recognises that those environmental management plans are a bit of a sticking plaster, and there's not actually a means of enforcing them properly if anything was to go wrong.
Okay, I just want to raise something that we heard in evidence from Wildfish on the 5th of June. They say that it takes SEPA a long time to gather evidence of harm caused to wild salmon. And in this quote, it said, SEPA estimates that it will take 5 years to collect that this type of evidence. And they say it's truly opposite of precautionary. Is there a problem with the time it takes to collect evidence of any harm caused by specific farms?
Yes, but I think again this is so. It's our understanding that SEPA's powers don't enable changes to existing licensed activities without evidence that environmental harm is occurring first. So SEPA can only prevent further deterioration from the point at which the new regulation is applied. So that's where that standstill lice threshold comes from. What that ultimately means is that any deterioration that was already occurring will continue to occur at that level. So it's not in line with the precautionary principle.
Okay. And because of the fairness of this whole situation where the government want to see the doubling of salmon farms by 2030. We also want to see wild fish protected. Do you think that the fact that you talked earlier about the lack of transparency in terms of the data on the website would have a detrimental impact to adopting the precautionary principle of the evidence that you're gathering before you actually rubber stamp a site?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
So how can all the evidence be gathered if SEPA doesn't have transparency on its website?
Okay, well, I would expect that SEPA's, that, you know, the information as the new framework comes forward will develop. So I think that's the point. A lot of the issues that we've had at the moment, and where a lot of the tension has come from, is that when a farm comes forward into planning, and I mentioned earlier on, the planning system is really a terrestrial planning system that's been trying to be used for something that's really quite dynamic. It's not like putting an extension on your house or building a factory or something like that. Basically, you've got a single point in time where everyone says, well, this should either go ahead or it shouldn't go ahead. What's actually important, particularly from a wild fish perspective, is actually everything that happens after that point of consent. So it becomes very binary between, well, does it get consent or does it not get consent? What is potentially useful, if SEPA's approach works properly, is that you can then look at the ongoing impact of that development over time, and you can change conditions and you can actually try to manage that as things go forward. It might be worth discussing with the Cabinet Secretary when she comes forward. I don't think Scottish Government have a policy to double salmon farming. I think the salmon farming industry has a policy to grow. I think the Scottish Government policy is to support sustainable growth, but I don't think they have targets in mind.
Okay.
And I don't think we should be setting targets without doing a proper strategic environmental assessment of what those targets would mean.
Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you, Dr. Wells. That's been fascinating. We could probably have kept you here for another couple of hours, but I appreciate you spending that little bit extra time with us. So that brings us to the end of this session in public. I'm too keen. I will now move on to the third item of business, which is consideration of a UKSI consent notification, the Windsor Framework Retail Movement Scheme, Plant and Animal Health Regulations 2024. Do members wish to make any comment on this instrument? No. Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provision set out in the notification being included in the UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Thank you. That concludes our business in public today, and we now move into private session.